Welcome to part three of our series on the language and culture of Hungary. Hi, my name is Peter Nemes, and in this lecture, we will review Hungary's current political climate and a few key social issues. So Hungary is a unitary parliamentary constitutional republic. This is what it's called, the Third Republic of Hungary. It means that Hungary is a democracy that has proper representation. It is based on a parliament. The major political parties that are currently in the parliament, with a couple of few smaller parties, are most importantly the ruling party is the Fidesz, or Hungarian Civic Union. It's a conservative party. Fidesz is an abbreviation from Young Democrats, Fiatal Demokrata Szövetség, but as they grew older, they became much more conservative. The Hungarian Socialist Party is the currently the biggest opposition. It's a leftist party, the origins of which go back to the socialist era, but it is simply to the left of the center party currently that used to be in power for several periods until it was ousted by Fidesz. And the third kind of important political power in the current Hungarian parliament is Jobbik, Movement for a Better Hungary. Jobbik means better or betterment. And those are a radical nationalist party with anti-immigration and xenophobic views. So these are kind of currently the three biggest parties. There are 199 seats in the parliament total, and 133 are occupied by Fidesz and its ally, the Christian Democratic Party. So that's a 66% majority, which allows them to really govern with certain kind of security. This is their second term, and they have been in power for, so that means they've been in power for some while. It also means that they changed the constitution, they had the power to do so, and they changed certain institutions, which drew quite a bit of criticism, both within Hungary and from outside of Hungary. But they are the legitimate governing party, the leader of which is the Prime Minister, Viktor Orbán, who has been the leader of Fidesz basically since its inception. In Hungary, the president, who is also currently from Fidesz, is mostly a figurehead. He is the commander-in-chief, but mostly has ceremonial position. He can veto laws, but other than that, he has not too much power. The power is concentrated at the prime minister, who is always from the winning elected party, and he has the power to elect, to nominate part of his cabinet. The parliament itself is housed in the famous Hungarian Parliament building on the banks of the Danube, and the government and the legislature is divided into four branches: the executive branch, which is the prime minister and his office; the legislative branch, which is mostly the parliament, although the executive branch has the power to bring legislature in front of the parliament; and then the judiciary, which is independent, of course, of these branches; and then finally the constitutional court. So this is a basic, fairly common setup for functioning democracies, and Hungary is part of that. Now, Hungary is also part of the European Union, which means that although it is an independent state, it also is part of a bigger unit. Joining the union means that certain rights and certain responsibilities are essentially given up, if you wish. They are handed over to the bigger unit. So a country like Hungary cannot make a decision about military engagement, for example, in its own. It cannot change laws about labor or about travel. And it has to abide by the rules of the European Union. It has been the part of the European Union since 2004, joining with a couple of other post-socialist countries. Being part of the European Union has a lot of advantages. It also means that Hungary has been in the news currently quite a bit because of one of the main social issues that we have to deal with currently. That's the refugee crisis from mostly Syria and Afghanistan and Iraq. Huge numbers of refugees are arriving mostly to the Serbian border until it has been closed down just very recently. Because Hungary is part of the European Union, they have to abide by the European Union's laws and register refugees. Unfortunately, there was not enough resources or political will to really do that. And the solution for the Hungarian government that they came up with was to close the borders. This is an incredibly complex problem. Refugees are fleeing wars and horrible conditions. And the Geneva Convention is, of course, in full effect in the European Union and in Hungary. So refugees have to be allowed entrance. But the sheer numbers and the logistics, the complexity, just overwhelm the country as a whole. And it is also a political question that has not been properly addressed. There are many people who try to help, and most of these people want to just pass through Hungary in order to reach Austria or Germany. But how they do it and how they're allowed to do it is still a question. This is something that affects Europe as a whole. Another very important social issue that is not just current, but has been a problem for a while and will probably be a question for a while, that is the question of the Roma minority. If you look at the ethnic makeup of Hungary, the overwhelming majority of people living in Hungary belong to the Hungarian ethnic group. They speak Hungarian and they are of Hungarian origin. If you look at the census data, there's about 14% or so who do not declare an ethnicity, but they most likely belong to the Hungarian group. The biggest minority in Hungary are the Roma, sometimes referred to as Gypsy, although Roma would be the better term to use. Their number is debated. It's between 3 to 5%, probably around 4% of the total population. They're by far the biggest minority, and they face certain socioeconomic problems that are typical for this, for the Roma as a whole. The historical origins are complicated and complex. This was a nomadic people who arrived late with a different identity, were not allowed to partake the same way in society as Hungarians, and the remnants of those are still felt. The unemployment rate is very high, Roma have a harder time with accessing certain services, education and healthcare. Crime statistics are higher because of that. Prison population is disproportionately higher than Hungarians. Issues that Hungary needs to solve. It's not alone with that. Europe, there are other parts of Europe that struggle with the Roma minority. Another social issue that we have to address is the declining population rate in Hungary. The population is 9.87 million, which is down from just a couple of years ago when it was around 10 million. So the declining population has a couple of reasons. One, it's the population is simply getting older, and the birth rate cannot keep up with the death rate, which again is not unheard of in this part of Europe or in certain developed countries, but Hungary seems to be affected proportionally bigger by that. Another factor in the decline of the population is the fact that there are many capable Hungarians, especially younger people, leaving Hungary. This is the fact that we call the brain drain. It has to do with a new generation growing up, speaking languages, and having the opportunities because of the European Union and its labor laws that allow for travel and taking jobs at other places, that they will seek opportunities for a better life. So recently, in the past couple of years, about 200,000 people for sure have left. The numbers are, of course, not exact, but about 200,000 people have left Hungary, which does put a strain on certain labor markets in Hungary, especially with highly skilled, like doctors or engineers, that are in shortage in parts of Western Europe where they can probably get better pay. So these are some of the key social issues. All of this said, Hungary is a very vibrant and interesting place that has a lot to offer, both for tourists and people who would like to do business. Thank you for watching our third segment on Hungary's language and culture. The next module will focus on Hungary's economy.
Thank you.